the time has come when we need to look for sustainable approaches for the continual sustenance of humanity. It is the right time when the humanity needs to learn and find means to coexist with the nature. It is because of this realization that the Department of Chemical Engineering has arranged for a webinar of this sort in order to make an impact among the students so that they will find themselves as co-participants in their endeavor to find sustainable approaches to green technology. Before we plunge into the webinar, I take this opportunity to welcome the resource person, Dr. Venkatesa Prabhu, Assistant Professor of Chemical Engineering, Addis Ababa Science and Technology University, Ethiopia. On behalf of the management, the principal, the staff, and the students, and on behalf of all participants, we extend a warm welcome to our research person, Dr. Venkatesa Prabhu Ali. Venkatesa Prabhu, welcome, sir. Next, I would like to welcome our chairman, line Dr. M. Stalin Arkaraj, and our CEO, ma'am, Professor Dr. Bridget Nirmala, the chief patrons to this webinar on sustainable approaches to green technology. On behalf of everyone, we welcome both of you, dear sir and ma'am. You're most welcome. Next, I would like to welcome our beloved principal, Professor Dr. S. Karpakam, our dean, Professor Dr. V. G. Kopinath, the head of the Department of Chemical Engineering, and the convener of this webinar, Professor Dr. Kida Managuran, and all the other staff and students of our college. Finally, let me welcome all the participants from various other engineering colleges across the states. You're all most welcome to this webinar on sustainable approaches to green technology. Once again, we welcome you all. Thank you. Now, before I hand over the session to the resource person, Dr. Venkatesa Prabhu, let us listen to a brief intro about our resource person. Dr. Venkatesa Prabhu received his doctoral degree in Faculty of Technology in Chemical Engineering from Anna University, Chennai. And his specialization is biochemical engineering. He has around 2 decades of teaching experience in engineering. And currently, he is working in Addis Ababa Science and Technology University, Ethiopia. He handles courses for the PG students of chemical engineering and for PhD scholars. His professional interest is on environmental engineering, biochemical engineering, food process engineering, and enzyme technology. At present, he has engaged himself in the research projects such as process optimization and kinetic studies on bacterial leaching of chromium from tannery sludge, then investigation of extraction techniques for recovery of collagen from tannery raw trimming waste, and third, development of water filter using metal nanoparticles embedded with activated carbon for point of use application funded by the Ethiopian government. He has published 27 reputed research publications. In addition to that, he also serves as referee for the journals such as the Journal of Cleaner Production, and next, Fresenius Environmental Bulletin, and finally, Environmental Engineering Research. He was awarded and honored the Young Scientist Fellowship Award in the year 2008 from Tamil Nadu State Council for Science and Technology for his contributions to collaborate research in nanocomposites at Chemical Engineering Department, Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. We are very happy to welcome you, sir. Now, I request the resource person, Dr. Venkatesa Babu, to take over the session, please. Yes, sir. Now you can go on. Click close.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
You're audible. We are very much audible, sir. You can go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Geeta Managuran head of the department for chemical engineering, and also the management and Department of Biotechnology head. Then for kind introduction about myself, Dr. Professor Arpada Prakasam sir, and also each and every one of you connecting me now to have a small discussion about green technology and allowing me to share my experience on green technology. Thank you so much, everyone, principal, Dr. Karpagam madam, and everyone. So it's not necessary to have a small introduction about myself, because already it has been given, doctor. So that I would like to go for my experience on green technology and what are all the current trends on this green technology that and all.
So you need to be a bit louder, please.
Thank you. So is it okay now, doctor?
Yeah,
it's okay. Okay, okay. Thank you everyone for joining me, and let me start my session running. Hope everyone can see my slide. Shall I start?
Yes, sir. So,
thank you.
You can start.
Okay. So, this is Dr. Vengadesa Prabhu. At present, I am giving my lecture for St. Michael's College of Engineering and Technology. So this is my topic, sustainable approaches to green technology. Okay. So what is green technology? What is the need of green technology? How the chemical engineering can supposed to be assist and associate for green technology? And also, I would like to discuss you what are all the things with respect to my experience on the green technology I would like to discuss with you, to share with you. Thank you. So let me move on the next slide. What is the exact definition for the sustainable future and everything? See, here I am giving my small definition for the sustainable here. Exact description, definition for the sustainable future, of course, impossible. I don't know how many of you are agree this one, right? From my point of view, and the people now who are working to look for the sustainable development, is of course impossible. Why? Because the small justification I have given here, even though we have to work towards the sustainable development, towards the sustainable point of view, to certain extent, one can define the condition that should meet whatever from the development will take. Is it? The concept sustainability is very best while defining by its boundary condition, because the sustainability at present, the term is defined by based on boundary condition limitations only. Now the possibility sustainability at present may not be impossible, impossible will be there because of, you know, now we are facing the pandemic corona. So how the sustainability will be there? This is the basic example, definite example, the corona situation, whether it is sustainable or not. So how to overcome this one? That's why. So the thing sustainable is based on the boundary conditions. What are all they? How we can define based on the sustainability, sustainable work? Here, I'm giving some 3 points. Only 3 points. Everything based on the limitations, because we have to finish it this session also within 1 hour, 1.5 hours time limitation, so that I could not, I cannot give all kind of limitations, all kind of possibility points to be discussed here. It cannot be. This is also based on sustainability also, right? Now, physical aspects, based on the environment, based on the planet, the prevention of depletion of essential resources, the environmental degradation, and the possibility of the biodiversity, that also one of the limitations, the boundary condition. Another also human aspects also we have to take care, that is equity, equality, and into what condition, education, and respect to the human rights, everything we have to take care, and economic aspects. Ultimately, all the thing, from basic person to the national and global level, the economic aspects is very, very important. So that is also we have to take care of the sound business. Also in the developing the countries, therefore the equity trading rights, the region. Not only the region, the community profit from the use of the resources, labor, space, infrastructure, material grown on demand. So these ways, three boundaries can define the sustainability that may be present. In future, yes, question mark. But we are working towards the sustainability. That is the thing how engineering and science, technology can work behind to make the sustainability work. But the sustainability, now I'm going to discuss with you with respect to the green. Why? That also I will give you the summary. See, this is the sustainability illustration diagram, how the sustainability can be framed by the different boundaries. The first one is the economics. Another one is the environment, another is the social. These two can break the boundary with respect to socio-economic. These two can create the based on economic and environment. But the thing, what you can see, the center, the boundaries. That only is sustainability indicator. That's only can create the sustainability, whether it is possible or not. So all these boundaries can meet together, can create the sustainability point of view. So we have to all, not only chemical engineering, all engineering science work towards the sustainability, how these boundary conditions to meet together to satisfy all those conditions, whether it is possible or not. Now, come to my home area, chemical engineering. So this chemical engineering touches everything. Of course, possible. Even it can touch all kind of area except some electronics, electrical point of view. Even also we are working, but some beyond the limitations, chemical engineers can work. It would like too long to list, but due to limitations, beyond the limitation, I can discuss with you. Chemical engineers can work in manufacturing, design of materials and everything, pharmaceuticals, healthcare design, construction materials, pulp and paper, petrochemical, food processing, and the specialty of the chemicals, microelectronics, even electronics, right? Advantages of the materials, polymer, recycling, business of services, biotechnology, environmental health, safety, industry, alternative energy sources, and green processing. Now the point, the green process, I am coming to touch at the end because the green is also very much important view of chemical engineers at present now. Among others, not limited to this, we are working. Chemical engineering challenges for sustainability. This, the small points, I would like to give you how the sustainability point of view chemical engineers are working, and also some challenges will be there. Whenever the challenges, we have to overcome it for the sustainability. To develop the compounds and material for the new product and the activity needed for the effective and the directive sustainable growth. That should sustainable for in future ever. That's why we the challenge. And lending to transition. To make growth possible, but in the sustainable manner, employing drastic reduction of resource use. We have to reduce the use of depletion of resources in production and application of the product also. Coming up with the product and process, fitting with market and condition in developing countries, and thereby stimulating growth, wealth, and further well-being also. These are all some challenges for the chemical, not only the chemical engineers, everyone are working with respect to their own work, but here I am just giving some points about the chemical engineering towards the sustainability. This is the small illustration about the sustainability, how long it takes for achievement of some particular domain of sustainability, the time and space. So we can express the work starting point to attain the sustainability work, how long it will take, and also how much work it will take, we can decide. So that small example of here in time and space with respect to the distance, with respect to time, the starting from chemical engineering equipment to the economy, right? So everything, chemical engineering starts from the equipment. Maybe it's a conical flask or test tube that starts from the laboratory to the marketing. It will take at least 1 decade, 10 years minimum. Then we can assess whether it is sustainability point of view we are working, sustainability achievement or not. And the sustainability assessment is different. That is different. So the economist and the different point of view parameters are there, whether it is sustainable or not. But however, it will take some hard work behind that and hard time to wait to attain the sustainability also. That's why I have given here from the equipment to process, process to enterprise and the supply chain with linked with others and life cycle, whether it is adaptable to life cycle of human being, because the human being life cycle and life expenditures and working service and everything vary with respect to different areas, also different countries, different regions. And also finally economy, it ends with finally economy. And also here, with respect to the human being, from starting microorganism to do until the nation and globe, also have some linkage between these things. So in space may take millions of meters and it may take some decades, may, but we have to overcome to sustainable, whether it is possible, even though we are finding to get the medicine for corona, whether it is possible for sustainability, or we are working under that one, sustainability medicine, right? So it will take some time. We have to wait for it. That also we have to agree. Understanding green technology. Base of green technology. What is green technology? What we have to work. Green technology is ocean. We can touch green technological work, any kind of work. But we have to understand what is green technology, what the work, the science and technology related to that and behind the green technology. Green technology or green tech is an umbrella term that can describe the use of technology and science to create the product that are more environmentally friendly. This is the term more. We have to concentrate on this term. More environmentally friendly. We can use environmentally friendly, eco, simply. But the green technology is concentrating towards more environmentally friendly. Okay, right. The goal of green tech is to protect the environment in some cases, even repair past damage done to the environment. That is the thing I would like to go for the coming slides. Damage has been occurred by somewhere else, someone else, but the green technology can work under this. How to repair the remediation? That also comes under the green technology. Examples of green tech include the technology infrastructure used to recycle waste, purify the water and air environment, create clean energy, and conserve natural resources. Not chemical resources. Natural resources we have to conserve. And that should be recyclable, that also. Zero discharge. So, working towards a zero discharge, and everything should be environmentally friendly work, that is also a major point important for the green technology. Remediation. Bioremediation of wastewater. So here the coming slides, I would like to discuss with you something about some part of the green technology. As I told you, the second part, remediation, that is the damage part should be remediable, remediation through the green technology. I would like to discuss with you because I am having some vast experience on that working regarding the bioremediation and also eco-friendly approach for the heavy metals, so that I start with bioremediation of wastewater. Why I have chosen specifically pharmaceutical? Because nowadays, the pharma time, everyone knows about this is the pharma time. No, so that's why I have just chosen about the bioremediation of wastewater. Not only waste comes for anywhere, even home itself, waste is coming. That also we have to be very careful while we are creating the waste. Okay, however, the creation, remediation, everything are working under the green technology. But here I would like to discuss something about pharmaceutical point of view, the wastewater, how to remediate. The bioremediation emerges as the most sustainable, economically viable option, bioremediation or biological degradation. This is nothing but the biological degradation. That means the heart or the toxins should be degradable by eco-friendly manner. That is known as bioremediation. This bioremediation techniques are treating xenobiotics. That means it's the peculiar term which is used by the biotechnologist. It's a compound or a substance which created by the organisms or compounds from the organism. It's a toxic. That is known as xenobiotics. Especially such kind of compounds are created or formed by the pharmaceutical wastes and also the plastics, the polymer. So we are simply using some terms. It's nothing but the biopolymers. It's very toxic. Such kind of things only very challenges to degradable, but some selective microorganism can take such kind of work, the plastic such as result of micro. So microbial transformation that makes water, that means wastewater, less toxic or more stable than initial polluted one. Even though different types of treatment methodology is there, the biodegradation makes very suitable to further treatment or it reduces the toxins. So initial polluted state compared, maybe it's zero or very less. These are all some classification of various types of pollutant in pharmaceutical industrial wastewater. So I could not, because due to time limitations, some vast different wastewaters are there, but this is the time for discussing pharmaceutical. That's why I would like to discuss with you pharmaceutical waste as well. So here, peculiarly, I am giving the type of pollutant. So the broad classification, the wastewater coming from pharmaceuticals, specifically heavy metals that can be used for catalysts and other things. So that may be arsenic and fluoride. Specifically, generally, most of the pharmaceutical industries are using arsenic. Maybe it's a poison we are using for medicines, arsenic. I have also worked a lot of things on the arsenic. So I will discuss with you my publication and everything regarding this. So heavy metals and ions. And the intermediates that we can use here, some acids and phenols, polyphenols and everything also will be there. Some drugs, so unusable. Which may be untreatable drugs also can be. Drugs metabolites, that means the derivatives of the drugs also. Finally, the polymers and packaging materials. So after packaging, the non-treatable package material like poly-density, high-density, polyethylene, everything will be there. These are all some major classifications of pollutant present in pharmaceutical industrial wastewater. So how we can treat such kind of wastewater? So here I have given small tabular column how we can treat the bioremediation process method application and efficiency. The simple condensed one I have given here. So the methods you can see here, the bacterial remediation, the first one, majorly most of the people are concentrating while the bioremediation process, the bacteria we are going to use. Active sludge method and upflow anaerobic without air. I will give you small definitions after that. Phytoremediation and phycoremediation and also fungal bioremediation. Then cyanobacterial bioremediation. These are all some different types of bioremediations. Normally the people are looking. Lot of researchers are still working under these categories. And also some sustainable methods have been still developing and to be developed also there. See, these are all some small idea about what I have discussed in previous, the bacterial leach. bacterial remediation. The different types of bacteria, such as endophytes, pseudomonas, and other strains of bacteria, as well as bacteria as yes, Bacillus subtilis have been employed in the treatment process. So anaerobic method of bioremediation, aerobic method of bioremediation. Aerobic is nothing but using of air, especially air is nothing but incense of oxygen. So aerobic method of bioremediation predominantly consists of activated sludge method. Activated sludge method means we are using some microorganism, and also while treating the microorganism or developing, while developing the microorganism, it consuming toxics. That consumption of the toxics is ultimately reducing its carbon oxygen demand and biological oxygen demand, so that the toxicity will be reduced. So that's the point of the aerobic metabolites and microorganisms are working. And also membrane batch reactor, the membrane is used to retain the microorganisms, and the membrane, the technology is different, is based on working with respect to the pressure technology. That is different, that I will tell you later. So anaerobic method of the many advantages over the aerobic method. Simply we can say the anaerobic methods are having more advantages. Why? Because we can consume, the consumption of power can be avoidable. Because while the aerobic process needs air, oxygen, in aerobic is not needed. So the compressor utilization of electricity, power, everything can be minimized or avoidable. So that anaerobic process, the people can be concentrated. See here, 1 kilowatt per hour of power can be utilized, can be minimized, avoidable for 1 kilogram of COD with respect to anaerobic metabolic process. Phytoremediation. Phyto, the name itself, using plant, the remediation can be done, that is known as phytoremediation. The phytoremediation is primarily in situ method of bioremediation. It is believed that any plant that grows in polluted site is a good phytoremediator. So whenever the microorganism is growing, it is utilizing some toxics. That toxics is unwanted by ourselves, human being, so that the plants can be used to remediate the polluted area. So this kind of activity is known as phytoremediation. I don't know how many people, the biotechnology people, have more awareness about phytoremediations. Okay, so the water plants, which is growing especially in wastewater, utilizing a lot of nutrient, micronutrient, toxics and everything. So that is the best example for phytoremediations. The next is fungal bioremediation. Using fungal, normally the fungals is the mold, so that can be grown, if you see, in food, Aspergillus niger. That can be best source of fungal which can be used for bioremediation. Aspergillus niger, Aspergillus fumigatus, Aspergillus nevus can be used for bioremediation. Actinomyces group, also the fungi, has been recognized, widely used to reduce or almost removal of carbon oxygen demand. So the carbon oxygen, oxygen demand, if you remove that one, the need of carbon to oxidize, need of oxygen to oxidize the carbon means the toxics, everything can be removed. There is no need of oxygen to remove any kind of toxics. That's why we have to concentrate on COD removal for the industrial wastewater. So phycoremediation, that is, if you use the microalgae, algae is type of microorganism that also can be used. Nowadays the people are working under this microalgae for bioremediation purpose. Simultaneously, the microalgae can be used for biodiesel. So the biodiesel, biofuel can be derived, some process. That also green technology, comes under the green technology. So the microalgae is a dual process, dual advantages. It also used for the remediation after the cultivation, the remediation. Now, microalgae derivative biofuel can be done. The use of species such as chlorella, pseudomonas, spirulina. So Desmodesmus. These are all some examples only. Okay, so if you go for some literature review, you can get lot of microalgae there. The microalgae bioremediation is now emerging and sustainable option. Maybe it developed for some other sustainable tool. Okay, so the pollutant from the wastewater, additionally, it provides the source of biofuel. That's why I have this. It can further use bioabsorption medium. So bioabsorption is one of the important unit operation in chemical engineering. It absorbs all the unwanted waste toxics. So it is clearly indicated that the algae is predominantly associated with the removal of heavy metals. Heavy metals is much more toxic to human being and environment. So it accumulates. Accumulates means it takes away. So the bioabsorption point of view also microalgae. After that, we can remove all the microalgae means we can remove all the toxic. Cyanobacteria in biobanks. Cyanobacteria is type of peculiar microorganisms. Okay, not stuck. Carnium is a low density polyethylene can be degraded by such kind of cyanobacteria. We know that LDP, polyethylene, polymer. That polymer can be degraded by this cyanobacteria. A lot of work, the remediation, the cyanobacteria can be done here. Membrane-based treatment. This membrane-based treatment is without a chemical, whatever the process is going on, that is the green technology approach. So that here the membrane can be used to remove the heavy metal or toxics, whatever may be present. This is the pressure-driven process, osmotic process, reverse osmosis, and everything we can use by using the membrane, separation, toxic, unwanted, waste materials, by separation of pure water or air, whatever may be using membrane, is one of the smart green technology approach. That's why membrane-based treatment is also comes under this green approaches. Bioremediation of metal contaminated environment. As I told you, so the area of chemical engineering can touch everything. So due to the time limitation, I would like to discuss with you something about because of this time limitations. So I'm having this kind of area vast experience, so that I would like to discuss with you bioremediation of metal contaminated environment, because now all area metals are there, especially for example electronics. Each and everyone are having more than 2 or 3 mobiles. Electronics have e-waste, creates e-waste. E-waste creates a lot of heavy metals. This is a simple chain, for example. 0.001% example I have given, right? So the metal contaminant, heavy metal contaminant spoils our environment very significantly. It's very dangerous one, right? Ultimately, only the metal and proportion will be there on the people dense area. It will be very harmful. We have to be very careful on using heavy metal, and heavy metal create pollutions. So bioremediation, how we can go for the green technology bioremediation on such kind of area? The heavy metals mechanisms has been classified by 2 different area. One is accumulation by accumulate and removal. That is known as metal immobilization. This is known as bioabsorption, bioaccumulations by complexation. That is agglomeration. We can create the agglomeration and remove by membrane process or filtration process. Next is precipitation, right? The precipitation is nothing but wherever the waste, e-waste, metal waste spread over. It looks like homogeneous, but we have to create a heterogeneous system by precipitating. The heterogeneous phase created by some bacteria, specifically hydrogen sulfate producing bacteria, can be used. So the metal reduction can be done by precipitating the metal by H2S precipitation. There is some mechanism behind that. So due to the time limitation, I could not explain all those things, the mechanism behind how the bacteria are interacting with metals and precipitating the metals. So this is my area. I am working lot of work on biosolubilization. This is separation of metal by immobilization. This is mobilization. That is the difference. So this is fixed metal. That is, metal has been fixed by adsorption or precipitation. This is unfixed. Oppositely, on other hand, the metal present in any contaminant environment can create solubilized one, that is the bioleaching, the biosolubilization. It can be created by different microbes. I will discuss with you some microbes here, the forthcoming slides. Before that, the mechanism is the metals are created by the microorganism to solubilize into media. Finally, the electrowinning process, application of some positive, negative electric field, we can precipitate very easily. Before that, we have to get solubilized. That one, the microbe can be used. This process is biosolubilization or bioleaching. Leaching means separation, especially. Now, my core area, I would like to discuss with you a lot of things here in bioleaching. Most of the people are working here towards the bioleaching in two different point of view. One is the mining, that is precipitate extraction process. Another one is environmental impact reduction process. That is two kind of work. The both are, I have done a lot of work. We have published most of the work here. Even my PhD scholar also, lot of work we have working at present here now. The bioleaching is nothing but simply bio mining. Generally, in this work have been started four decade back itself. In 1950, 1960s itself, the people have started in US and the different countries about bioleaching using microbe extracting the metal. This process is mining or biohydrometallurgy. That is the natural process of interaction between microbe and mineral. I will tell you, some peculiar microorganism are working. It has some interaction between the material. There are also some limitations of that also I will tell you. That is, extract the valuable metal from the wall to help of microorganisms such as bacteria or archaea. So here I am working a lot of work under the bacteria. How metal can be extracted? Metal can be solubilized. Possible, but there is some limitation. Some bacteria, some peculiar bacteria, some peculiar metal can be extracted. That is specific one. Okay, so specific microbe using specific condition, specific metals can be extracted. But the thing is bio, eco-friendly, without any harmful chemicals. For example, if you want to extract the gold, you have to use a lot of harmful chemicals like cyanides. But the gold can be extracted by microbe. Possibility. Right? Right. See here. This is the simple schematic diagram. Bioleaching of low-grade sulfide ore. Low-grade means usually the people working high-grade ore. High-grade ore means the metal sulfates are having more than 50% age. So we can use harmful chemicals, concentrated acids, and some additional catalysts. The catalysts are very, very dangerous. We are creating the reaction very fast. For that purpose, we are using the catalyst, and also we are minimizing our lifespan using the catalyst, so that the catalyst is very harmful. I'm telling that. Okay, so that the bioleaching can be used low grade, so the people always not concentrating on the low grade, but here the bioleaching is concentrating on low grade sulfide ore. See, just metal sulfate, simply I am indicating metal sulfate MS. It has been crushed here and using the microbe and metal crushed particle. Why we are crushing means to increase solid surface ratio. That is the interaction between the particle microbe should be increased. That's why we are crushing the materials, ball mill or rod mill, different types of mills are there. So even fine particle can be used whenever the reaction rate can be used. This is the bioleaching reactor. Here the microbe and the minerals are getting interacted towards. So the optimized microbe means the selected microbes, the choosable microbe. And microorganism, environment is also very, very important, these two. That is the thing the people, chemical engineering or biotechnologists are working towards the sustainability to optimize the microbe, optimize the process, environment means. Different factors are there. If you give the proper optimized condition, that process will be the sustainable forever, right? So this, after this interaction, the leachate will come. Leachate is nothing but the solubilization. So we have created using this microorganism, the solubilization of metal. After the solubilization, you can recover the metal very easily by electrowinning process, right? If you apply the electricity, the metals will be precipitated as a plate or some particular rod, whatever may be. It's a simple biological method. Only thing is, finally, even you are using electrical, that also is green technology, comes under the green technology. Finally, the extracted metals are used. So this is the process flow diagram bioleaching simply we are using for different types of material, especially sulfide ore. Whatever, whenever the metal are attached, metals are combined with the sulfide, so the microbe can be used for that ore. Zinc, chalcopyrite, that means copper, realgar, arsenic, manganese, iron. Iron is pyrite. Pyrite is the important word for the iron. Even indirect bioleaching, uranium and thorium, such kind of also, we can now the concentrating to extract the ore using microbe. This is the mechanism behind the direct bioleaching, indirect bioleaching. Most of the people are getting amazed about that. How microbe can solubilize the metal. Metal is very impossible to solubilize, is it or not? Yeah, I know that. So that here the direct and indirect mechanisms normally the proposed by the people, researchers. This is the pyrite. The pyrite is nothing but FeS2 is the basic ore of microbe. It has been converted with respect to FeSO4. This form, the sulfate form, oxidized by the microorganism by sulfate. This is the solubilized to the water. If you add water, ferrous sulfate will be solubilized. If you add water with the FeS2, that is pyrite, it will not be solubilized. So the oxidation through the microorganism, here the microbe activity is there, so that the solubilization has been taken care. This is the direct bioleaching. So pyrite, bacteria converting this. So behind that iroprotein, what is the activities going on, the microbe, everything is lot of mechanism is there, because the microbe, the bacteria needs catalyst of from the energy source. That is, the energy source means it needs sulfide, right? It's taking oxidation, SO4, the electron is needed for the survival of microorganism. So the conversion has been taking place. And also one of the things, it creates sulfuric acid, H2SO4. This sulfuric acid is responsible for again solubilization of this metal. So the two-way activity, direct oxidation, this is soluble, and this is the sulfuric acid which is responsible to solubilize again this one, right? So finally the solubilization form has been taking place, the leaching has been taking place. This is indirect bioleaching. Indirect bioleaching is copper. This is the chalcopyrite. The copper ion sulfate is nothing but the chalcopyrite. Normally the people are extracting the iron and the copper by the chalcopyrite, but we are using microbe. So this microbe, this is the overall equation, right? The copper has been solubilized and iron has been solubilized by the water. Why? How? See, this is the simple equation. Ferrous ion is oxidized by the ferric ion. This ferric ion is getting attacked by this FeCu, FeS2. Then the ionized form can be taken place. It can be solubilized. It has been removed. Another thing is normal ferric is converted by ferric ion. This is ion oxidizing bacteria. The two kind of different bacteria we are using for this one. One is ion oxidizing bacteria, sulfur oxidizing bacteria. Sulfur oxidizing bacteria just oxidizes the sulfur to sulfate. The sulfur individual, elemental sulfur as individual cannot be solubilized by the water. But this bacteria has been solubilized by taking energy sources of sulfur. So this is nothing but sulfuric acid, sulfate plus hydrogen, right? H2SO, right? So this is sulfuric acid is responsible for again solubilization of complex ore. So this is the bioleaching mechanism behind how the metals are getting solubilized by the bacteria. So this is indirect, this is direct. Okay. So next is, I would like to, due to time limitation, I would like to go fast on. These are all some bacteria normally we are working under the bioleaching process here. Gram negative and gram positive. The gram negative bacteria is Acidithiobacillus paraxylans and Thiobacillus paraxylans, and also has been, with respect to the gene sequence, the alpha, beta, and the genomics and everything, we have several classifications are there. The probacteria is known as gram negative and the bacteria gram positive. I am having vast experience on this bacteria. This bacteria, Leptospirillum ferruculum, I have isolated and I have submitted the gene sequence also, because this is very peculiar. It's ion oxidizing bacteria. So that the sulfobolus and the different actinobacteria, different bacteria are there. See here, leptospirillum ferruculum. So by me, it has been isolated, and the gene sequence has been submitted to the GenBank. So this GenBank is submitted in 2000. So 14 or 13. So has been submitted by me and my co-worker, Dr. Bhaskar. This one, the culture has been isolated. Chitradurga copper pyrite mine. The Chitradurga copper pyrite mine, you know, the KGF, Kolar gold field, Karnataka is there. So we have observed some samples, and in that samples, the microbe have been isolated. And fortunately, we are not expecting that this microorganism will be obtaining. But the Leptospirillum ferruculum could not be obtained. It's very peculiar microorganism. Fortunately, we have observed that, and we have characterized it and submitted to National Bank USA, that is the National Collection of Bioinformatics Centers, NCBI. We have submitted, and gene sequence also partially we have done and confirmed this microorganism. This microorganism using, we have worked in different areas under environmental point of view and bioleaching point of view. This work, bioleaching of zinc. Zinc is the major ore, zinc sulfide. Is that an yes? Sphalerate. So bioleaching of zinc, the sphalerate, leptospirillum ferruculum, effect of temperature and kinetics. Here, as process engineer, how we develop the sustainability work? That is, increasing the rate of the reaction towards minimizing the cost and also yield to be increased. So we have just submitted this article, the temperature and kinetics. Why the kinetics? Being chemical engineer, we are, that means the chemical engineer concentrating on kinetic based, because the sustainability towards the economic point of view. Without the kinetics, you cannot design any kind of reactor. So without reactor, we cannot implement any kind of pilot. Without any pilot, we cannot go for any kind of industrial work. So that the kinetics is very, very important. It's nothing but basic modeling work. So this work have been just carried out in our area, the Addis Ababa Science and Technology University. It's a Springer journal. We have applied biological chemistry. And bioleaching of zinc and iron. Whenever you go for the ore, zinc only will not be there. There may be some iron. But here, the kinetic aspect using Leptospirillum ferruculum, pulp density, we have worked about how much feed can be given. So microbe have some tolerance value. So we cannot eat 100 kilo of food at a time, right? So how many idli can be taken? Well, maybe possibility 7 or 8 or 10, right? It is not possible more than 10 or 20, whatever maybe. So that the feed input of pulp density. Pulp density is nothing but the ore input, how much we are going to leach. So the work towards the sustainability process development, the process optimization can be done here. This work has been carried out and published in National Scientific Technology Scopus Index Journal. So we are working towards the pulp density, how much feed can be input and how much yield can be done by the isolated microorganism. Separately, zinc and iron we have worked. So the good developed process has been obtained here in this work results. Another is the effect of Fe2. I told that Leptospirillum ferruculum is iron oxidizing bacteria. It utilizing iron and converting ferric ion. That ferric ion is possible for leaching sulfide ore. So here the sulfide ore zinc is the sphalerate. Is that an yes? That is should be separated by zinc and sulfur using food of microbe Fe2, that is ferrous. This surface ferrous converted into ferric ion, so that the effect of ferrous has been carried out in this research work. Here also the kinetics has been carried out. Good results will have observed by our researchers, me and Dr. Bhaskar, and also some of our colleagues from Ethiopia also. We have worked under this work, and it has been published recently, October 2019, last year only, but the work has been carried out two years along. Okay, so here the another work, kinetics of iron bioleaching, the same microbe, the effect of temperature. All biological systems are significantly affected by the temperature, even everything. Maybe corona, I don't know. But the thing of temperature is very, very important. Here, now it's heavy raining. I am wearing coat and everything. The temperature is now 12 degrees centigrade. Now it's here 12 to 13 degrees centigrade. So the variation of temperature is very much influenceable by the metabolic things of microbes. From the microbe to human being, right? Everything will be affected by the temperature. So that the temperature, attitude, everything, we are carried out by using our microbe, Leptospirillum ferciflorum. And also always, being a chemical engineer, the kinetics and modelings has been carried out that can be done towards sustainability of creating the novel reactor systems development. That is the reactor. And so that's why the kinetics we have carried out, right? So here my PG Scholar have been carried out. Just it has been published in 2019. So the ion bioleaching only we have carried out here, right? Next is the bioleaching kinetics of chalcopyrite. I already told you chalcopyrite is nothing but iron and copper combinations. So this iron bioleaching and copper bioleaching, concentrate of leptospirillum ferciflorum, effect of silver ion. So always towards the green technology. But some point of view, we have to compromise how to improvise our the system by the rate of leaching and by the yield. Here, the silver ion is increasing the rate of the reaction very significantly. So the research has been carried out to improvise our rate, because bioleaching can be carried out more than 2 months or 3 months, 90 days to 60 days, minimum 60 days it will take to remove, because all biological systems are very slow. Chemical systems are very, very fast, except some enzymatic reactions. All biological systems are very, very slow. For the sustainable point of view and also the yield and environmental point of view, we have to concentrate on improvisation of the rate and also yield. So that the catalyst we have used here as silver ion, it has shown good result. So this work has been carried out with respect to the rate of the leaching, and chalcopyrite, copper and iron extraction has been carried out. This is the biosolubilization of chromium. Recently, this work is funded by Ethiopian government. At present, I am the I am the principal investigator of this work. Beyond our the green technology work to extracting bioleaching, the environment point of view. So I told you the bioremediation. Already the damaged one should be repaired by the microbe, so that the biosolubilization of chromium. Chromium is very toxic on each and everyone know that. Here, Ethiopia, one of the important economic commodity is leather. The leather processing industry, Ethiopian leathers are very famous to each and every country. Ethiopian leather and Ethiopian food, this is uncompromisable here. So wherever you go, if, Ethiopia or anywhere, if you adapt, if you opt the Ethiopian leather, that should be very, very nice. I will tell you, right? It's a small suggestion for me. So here, the biosolubilization, the chromium, which is unwantedly removing from the industry, has been removed by the microbe that has been carried out. As per my point of view, the sustainability, so the process modeling and optimization, where you optimize, mean it will be sustained, right? So that we are optimizing all those things, the rate kinetics, the thermodynamics point also we are discussing here. So it has been published recently in 2019 only. So past 3 years, we have worked a lot of things, and now we are getting started towards publication, getting what we have got all the results here. So this is a good opportunity to discussing all those things with you people, right? So this is my co-principal investigator, Girma Gonka, director of research, and this is me. So the thermodynamical point of view, we had a lot of good results. And this one, the Leather Research Development Institute, I would like to acknowledge here, the Leather Industry Development Institute had good cooperative and good analytical techniques they have provided. So he is the man who has helped me a lot to industrial point of view, the leather extraction, leather waste and everything. So I would like to thank this person also, Mr. Birma. And this is the waste sludge, what we had collected from the leather processing industry. A lot of chromium content waste will be there. So using this sludge, we have used our microbe and removing almost 98% of toxic chromium 6 have been removed from this microbe, from this sludge. Next is the kinetics of heavy metal solubilization from electroplating sludge. So this is electroplating, you know, lot of heavy metals we are using on electroplating. So from zinc, copper, lead, what different kind of heavy metals, especially. So that the waste electroplating sludge is also having lot of toxic heavy metals. So the microbes, Ajit Ayobasilus foraxerens, that also my isolate. We are just working under this microbe, and also kinetics of biosolubilization, electroplating sludge, effect of sulfur. This is sulfur-based bioleaching we have worked. So putting sulfur as the food, sulfur to sulfuric acid, that sulfuric acid is responsible for solubilization of electroplating heavy metals. So sulfur is food of our microbe. What is the microbe? Ajit Ayobasilus. How the optimization and kinetics and everything we have done, just submitted to Journal of Korean Society for Applied Biology. It has been published in 2015 itself. So 5 years back itself, we have worked under this. So my co-research is Dr. Bhaskar. While I was in India, I have carried out this work. And another the same, the electroplating sludge bioleaching process kinetic detoxification. So this work is also electroplating sludge. This is the sulfur effect. And another one we have carried out about pulp density. The Polish Journal of Environmental Studies, we have published, I think, this is also 2015. So this process, the kinetics, has been carried out for the sustainable work with respect to the pulp density. This work is also very peculiar and very nice because the electroplating sludge is very toxic. Among the toxic metals and toxic heavy metals, our microbes are working. That is the sustainability. So I'm very happy to discuss with you all those things, right? And this work I have recently advanced, the working about the realgar, right? What is realgar? Realgar is nothing but the arsenic ore, AsS2. Realgar is arsenic. You know, arsenic is very, very poisonous heavy metal. This poisonous heavy metal can be isolated by leptospirillum ferritin. So that how much the tolerable against the toxics and poisons this microbe. That's why the microbes is also green technology and tolerable and everything for the toxic heavy metals also. So this work is published in Journal of Biological, Chemical and Physical Sciences. So this work has been carried out in Addis Ababa Science and Technology. So the mineral has been leached by this microbe, and the process development, that means already existed one to developed for the newer sustainable one, has been carried out. The effect of Fe2 towards the arsenic. Arsenic is medicinal and poisonous, can be used very effectively by the medicinal point of view. That's why the green leaching have been carried out. Now, bioremediation and biofuel. So simultaneously we can work under the bioremediation and biofuel. See, the power plant, the toxics which can be affiliated as unwanted air pollutant can be filtered. That filtered CO2 can be used for utilizing one of the important nutrients for the algal cultures. So this is the agriculture, municipal wastewater and anaerobic digester effluent from the treatment of wastewater. So after this, we can get together, which can be used for the algal culture. This is one of the important bioremediations. This the algal culture can be converted towards for the oil extraction. That is hydrocarbon is nothing but biofuel. This is the bio-based byproduct can be used for the nutrient value added product for food development process, that is for cattle and for animal feed we can use. So bioremediation towards the biofuel, that's also. So finally, the trans esterification and biodiesel, everything can be, this is a food production, this is the environmental impact point of view, we can work bioremediation. Next, some discussion I would like to give you by surfactant, biosurfactant. What is surfactant? Surfactant is nothing but, that means it can be enhanced the solubilization of unsoluble matters. So unsoluble compound and matter can be easily soluble by using such kind of biosurfactant. The biosurfactant compound have added much deliberate sense because why? Considered as responsible option and eco-accommodating the material for remediation technology. Eco-accommodating, that is the thing. It has been create the environment to unsolubilized one to solubilized one. That is, it can be accommodated, right? Wanga. Accommodate panel. It had been used. That is biosurfactant. During the growth of metabolism, different microbes such as bacteria, yeast, fungi can synthesize surface bioactive microbes. So these are all the fungi, yeast, bacteria are the sources of biosurfactant. Biosurfactant is nothing but the compound. It's simply we can say as bioenzymes. So basically the oil industry, okay? So the oil industries, we are concentrating towards bioremediation. Biosurfactant we are using. So these are all some advantages, strengths and disadvantages. Whenever we are seeing whether it is advantages or disadvantages. Advantages is more means we can go so simply, blindly we can go. So this is a simple condensed idea. High purity, environmentally friendly, so low cost, non-toxicity, good emulsifying. This is one. The good emulsifying is nothing but the microbe that is unsolubilized and the hydrophilic, hydrophobic. Both are combined in one molecule, is having biosurfactant, surfactant, right? So it can emulsifying very easily. Only thing is expensive compared to some chemical things. And also another is prospects, the market value, food, and low investment needed, and low cost of production. These are all some positives with respect to the business. And high production yield and low cost chemical products, some treats are there. So this is these are all very low when compared to advantages. Biosurfactant, I want to give small introduction about this. The people who are working under most of the biotechnologies, food technologies, environmental engineers and chemical engineers are now looking for to get PhD, so the people can concentrate on this one to create and production of biosurfactant. The biosurfactant are the chemical compound characterized by hydrophilic and hydrophobic, the polar and non-polar, having single molecule. That is the thing. Okay, so the surfactant from the bacteria, cyanobacteria and fungi, yeast, both are this can be classified into glycolipids and lipopeptides and the phospholipids and everything. So psychology, physiological role of biosurfactant, how the mechanism behind the surfactant, increase the availability of hydrophobic compound. Okay, so water fillet, water loving compound, so it can be easily solubilized. So oil can be converted, oil cannot be solubilized, so oil can be converted to solubilized by biosurfactant, surfactant, but the microbe creating the surfactant is biosurfactant. So hydrophobic compounds are enormously, very significantly increased. So nutrient storage micromolecules, so molecules, so nutrient storage, it can be used as nutrient storage. Save the microbial cell and toxic compounds. So next step, efflux of harmful compounds. Harmful can be evacuated. Extracellular, intracellular interactors such as very good medium, it can be used for biofilm and everything also. Biosurfactant. Biosurfactant application in bioremediation. This is our work. The microbe can assess a purely water-soluble surfactant, right? Purely water-soluble substrate that has been pseudo-solubilized. So pseudo-solubilized means that is background. It is working as a background, right? Not in major. It's working as a background to increase the solubilization. That's why. By the biosurfactant. Reduce absorption and non-polar pollutant of the surfactant as a soil practice. So next is the green technology, that is green engineering through the energy recovery from the waste. This slide is the simple condensed one, how the green energy can be from the waste. Nothing but from the waste using fermentation and fermentation to finally green energy. Green energy is nothing but final methane, how methane can be obtained, right? So some bacteria are working towards by the methanization or fermentation and acetic acid and H2CO2, everything can be created, the mechanism behind that. Finally, the methane has been produced. This is the point, how from waste to energy can be. This also now the people, the current trend towards green energy. So I think the given time 1 hour has been successfully I am completing now. And also this is only some points only I have discussed, and I have discussed about my some experience on green technology leaching, bioremediation, bio leaching. So nowadays the people are concentrating about the green cement and also green recovery, green extraction, everything, green materials, green construction materials. Okay, so if possible, I think it may be a series to discuss about the green technology towards a sustainable one. And also nowadays the people are working ultrasonics. The ultrasonic method of extraction is also one of the important extraction for the green technology. Instead of using harmful compound of extracting solvent, you can use ultrasonic sound before the extraction. So simply water can be used as solvent before that you have to use some microwave or ultrasonic. This is also one of the green technology. Nowadays people are using ultrasonics by getting the susceptible micromolecule. If you add water, then all the molecules are getting extracted. That is also one of the green technology. And also green cement. So maybe the people are getting bored beyond if you go after 1 hour, so that I would like to stop at this. So if the time permits, if the same kind of opportunity, so will be obtained again. So we'll be discussing all those things, different novel and sustainable trends towards the green technology. So I would like to wind up my session with small discussion about the green technology. I thank everyone connecting me and Dr. Geeta to give me such kind of good opportunity, and for the host and Dr. Surya Narayanan sir, Karpagam madam, management, and everyone. I thank everyone. So if possible, the time permits, we will meet again soon with some more lot of new results. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Video? Okay, fine. Mine is not working. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir, for your lecture. And we have few questions from the participants. Now, do you like to take them up?
Please, sir. Please. Have the pleasure.
Yeah. Now we have one question from Dr. B. Karpagam. The question is, how feasible is the use of bio-leaching in the extraction of base metals from smelter slag?
Yes.
Have you got the question?
Yeah. Smelter slag is waste from metal processing industries. Feasible means, I don't know for which kind of expectation madam having, but only thing is bio-leaching, using bacteria, using fungi, having some limitations. That's why the people are working still. The success is hindered because of, if you give instead of 10 gram for 1 gram, instead of 10 gram for 1 gram, the results may affect. Instead of 1 gram, if you give 10 gram, the results may affect. So the prototype work before we go to implement the pilot studies or industrial studies, laboratory studies should be very carefully done with respect to the bacteria or with respect to the base metals. Base metals, madam is asking about the base metals, right? So I have worked with different base metals. Whenever the work under carried out the sulfide point of view, sulfide ore, the work should be very successfully. And also the compatibility with respect to bacteria and combinations of bacteria and the proper optimal condition should be defined properly in laboratory. Then the process model and model can be implemented to the pilot plant, so that it is much possible the waste from the metal processing industries. I have worked under electroplating waste and also chromium waste, so different heavy metal waste also we can try. So that's why towards the sustainable work should be done. And also we don't know, just we have observed only some bacteria cutter the kaiman alavu, so we have to explore different bacteria. Nobody knows about leptospirillum ferruflum can work under the arsenic. It's a toxic heavy metal. But now we are implementing, giving some optimal condition and getting good results. So the research is much needed. Research is much needed before to implement.
Okay, thank you, sir. We have one more question. And this is from Mr. Balamurugan.
Yes, sir.
The question is, can you tell us how the concentration of sulfur will affect the slag?
Ah, sulfur, is it, sir?
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
How the concentration of sulfur will affect the slag?
I had a small experimental result with respect to concentration on sulfur. So I have isolated in the same site, Chitradurga copper mine, Acidithiobacillus ferox-sidens. Acidithiobacillus ferox-sidens is sulfur oxidizing bacteria. Elemental sulfur is non-soluble to the water. So whenever the media formulation which work under such kind of work, while you add sulfur, the sulfur to be converted to sulfuric acid by the bacteria, then only microbial leaching will taking place. Okay, so if you add more, that is surplus concentration of sulfur, it will provide some irritational environmental for oxygen solubility, so that the concentration while you add, so in that point of view, partially that is fed batch system is going to be used. Chemical engineering are people are know that about the batch system, fed batch system and continuous system. Here the fed batch system is while utilizing the sulfur, depleting the sulfur and depleting sulfur rate, we are adding another concentration of the sulfur. If you add more concentration of sulfur, it will affect the oxygen solubility, because the oxygen environment, the solubilizer concentration of oxygen is very, very important. So it will create lot of influence, negative influence, so that the optimal addition initially, after utilizing the microbe, again we have to add some amount of sulfur. This is the point we have to be very careful working under the sulfur reducing microorganisms. So the concentration is very, very important.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Now we have one more question, and this is from Ms. Annalakshmi. The question is, how feasible is iron bioleaching? How feasible is iron bioleaching?
Yes, sir. Okay. So here, iron, the microbe, initially 30 years back, that was identified, which is used only for iron bioleaching, because the microbe is utilizing iron only. Iron means the pyrite iron has been converted, utilized by the microbe to convert ferrous sulfate. The ferrous sulfate is soluble one. So that iron bioleaching is very much good feasible. So the 2017, I had a small visit on 2016 or 17, Indian Mineral Institute, the National Regional Laboratory at Pune, Odisha. It's only working for mineral materials and minerals engineering there. So Dr. Lakshmi Ratan Chukla, one of the professors, he is working much
Hello. So there is no audio from your side. Vengadesh sir. There is no audio from your side, please. We are still waiting. We have okay. Thank you so much, sir. Since we could not retrieve the audio, and we thought it would be nice that we wind up the session now. We have come to the final stage of the webinar. I'm here to propose a formal word of thanks. First of all, we express our heartfelt thanks to the resource person, Dr. Vengadesha Prabhu, for accepting our invitation and consenting to deliver a lecture on sustainable approaches to green technology. On behalf of the chairman, the CEO ma'am, the principal, and especially on behalf of the convener, we extend our profound thanks to you, dear sir. Let me also thank all the participants from every other colleges across the state for their overwhelming support. Let me thank the panelists and the technical staff who have helped for the success of this webinar. Let me thank each and every one who have contributed towards the success of this webinar. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.